Hello and welcome to today's UAD webinar entitled UAD Made Simple. What is UAD? UAD stands for Uniform Appraisal Data. It's an initiative by Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac to get certain fields of data from the forms to review that data before they make a loan determination. So they're trying to minimize their risk by getting certain information from the report and looking at that before they make a determination on a loan. And for them to get that information in the most technically efficient manner possible, they want a couple things. They want, in some cases, new information in certain fields in the form. In others, they want specifically formatted information. And then they want that information transmitted as an XML file. And some of the examples of the new information they want is in the location and the view fields. They want like terms like neutral, beneficial, and adverse, instead of terms like average, good, poor, fair. Some of the formatting examples are if a field asks for a date, it can only contain a date which is numbers and slashes, and the format for the date needs to be specifically two-digit month, slash two-digit date, slash four-digit year. Another example of formatting is if a field asks for a number, it can only contain a number, no letters or other symbols. It needs to be a number and round to the nearest whole number. Now there are currently four forms under the UAD initiative. Not all the Fannie Mae forms are, even though Fannie Mae says at some point down the road they will be. But it's these four forms that is currently under the initiative. The 1004, the two condo forms, the 1073, the 1075, and then the 2055. And bear in mind, it's not the forms themselves that change. It's just the information that goes into certain fields on these forms needs to be, as I said earlier, new information in some cases, specifically formatted in others. So what has Bradford Technologies done by way of ClickForms to accommodate these changes? We've created a UAD mode in the program. Under the Services menu, you'll see this option for UAD Compliance On. If you don't have this option when you click on Services, you need to get an update. The current update for ClickForms is 7.4.8. You can either get that from the Help menu and click Check for Updates. And if it says you don't have any and you still don't have a certain option, then something's wrong. You need to go to Plan B and get the update through the website. Either there's a technical issue that's caused it or you're too far back in update for it to recognize that there's a current one. Just close out the program and go to our website, www.bradfordsoftware.com, and then you can download and install the current update from there. But if you do have under Services UAD Compliance On, that will get you to the options window for UAD. On the right, you can turn it on and off by checking this box. With the checkbox in, it's on. If you uncheck it, it'll be off. This just talks about some options when you are in UAD mode. And then on the left, it gives you the UAD interfaces. It's not like one versus another. They're sort of all layered. You know, you can use all three in conjunction with whatever provides the best and easiest way for you to fill out a report. UAD First Look is primarily what we're going to go over. It's the best and surest way to get a totally complete, compliant UAD report. It uses color coding to indicate the fields that are coming under the UAD requirements and also has pop-up windows to assist you with filling in the proper information in UAD format. UAD Power User, we'll go over that a little bit. It's a way to sort of fill out the information a little more quickly and efficiently. And then transfer is a sort of an inspection sheet where you fill in the information. It's sort of ordered, so it's a little more quick and more efficient. They don't have pop-up windows. They have sort of pre-tab drop-downs, so you can fill in a little more quickly and efficiently, and then transfer it to the report. The only potential downside with that is it does allow you to put in information potentially that's not UAD compliant when you transfer it into the report. It'll let you go in, and then it will tell the field, it'll turn the field orange if that's the case, and orange is an indication of a non-UAD compliant field. So the first look has got the pop-up windows, which may, you know, get in the way or take a little bit longer to fill out, but it will not let you get out of the field if it's not compliant. The power user doesn't have the pop-up windows, but there are some situations where you may be able to create a report that's there are fields in the report that are not compliant, but it will identify those in orange, and that will be a cue, hey, you have to clean those up. UAD specialist will deal with down the road a month or two, and it will deal with the import of third-party data coming in from NLS, public records, 1004MC, map and sketch. That data will still come into your report even when you're under UAD. It's just if it's not UAD compliant, which most likely it won't be, then it will be in compliant. It'll turn the field orange, and then you'll just know you'll have to go into those orange fields and correct the formatting and the information so that it is compliant with the UAD requirements. Well, once UAD specialist hits, you won't have to do that. It'll sort of convert the data for you before it rolls into the form. So when it comes in, it'll automatically be UAD compliant, and you can just take off from there. We're going to go ahead and leave these options the same in the WMF itself. If you create a report, either with a template, a clone a file from scratch, opening an existing file, it's going to ask you this question. I'm going to go ahead and create it from a template. It will ask you, this is a non-UAD compliant report. Do you want to apply the UAD compliant rules, yes or no? If it doesn't require the UAD rules, you can answer no, and then the report and the program will function exactly as it has before UAD, sort of status quo, business as usual. You just go from there. If it does require the UAD tenants, then you would hit yes, and that will do a couple things. I'm going to go ahead and hit no and open up my report. I've already got started for this. If I can get to there, come on. Sorry about that, dreaded technical glitch. All right, so I've already got the report started, and what it will do is it will turn the fields that are under the UAD requirement when you turn it on in green. All the fields that are green are under the UAD requirements. The blue fields are not. Now, your empty fields may not be blue. That's the default color, but the UAD fields will definitely be green. So green means an into a UAD field, and you can see here not all the fields by any means are UAD fields. About a third of them on page one. We get down to the grid. It's kind of a sea of green. They want a lot more grid, you know, almost all the grid information, including all of the adjustments potentially. So most of those are green. And then we'll go to page three. The cost approach has a few UAD fields. And then finally, let me go to page six, the certification or signature page. It's got some company name, address information, the date the report was signed, effective date, your licensing information. Let me talk about the licensing information, something that's come up when UAD has gotten going here. They want either the certification information or the licensing information. They don't want both. So if you put both certification and license information in, that will get rejected and be considered invalid. They want one or the other. The premise basically is, or the implication is, if you're certified, the assumption is you're licensed. So if you're certified, you just have to provide the certified information, certification information, but not the licensing information. If you're simply licensed, then you provide that information. So just know that. Also, for the lender-client name here at the bottom, there's company name and lender-client name. Lender-client name is specifically the name of the management company. That's what needs to go there. The company name is generally the bank. Now, if you're just dealing with a management company, it would be the same for both. But the lender-client name specifically needs to be the name of the management company. And just so you know that, if some questions have come up in the course, that is what's required for that field. Let me talk. I have a UAD two-page definition of terms form. It's an optional addendum to add. You can set it to add by default. It's not technically required, but it's highly recommended that you add this form, this two-page addendum form, and most of your lenders will probably require it. Page one of the definition shows the condition ratings and definitions, the C1 through C6 that I'm sure you've all heard of. It details word for word what the definition of C1 through C6 is. And then also the quality of construction rating definition, Q1 through Q6, details here word for word what they are. Then at the bottom it talks about improvement definitions. They're looking for improvements of the subject property. They're looking, what is defined as not updated, updated and remodeled. And then also the bathroom count, and we'll go into that about what you need to, how you need to define the bathroom. And then also page two of this is a list of abbreviations that are used for UAD. what the abbreviations stand for, and then on the right here, some of the fields they show up. Like, again, this isn't required, but it's highly recommended, and many of your lenders probably will require it. It's a good thing to have in there, particularly for the end recipient of the appraisal, the borrower, so they can kind of look at it and understand some of the information that is now being required to be put in the report. But it may be for the lenders, the underwriters, even for yourselves as you're going through, you can refer to it relating to UAD stuff. All right, and then the UAD subject details. This is kind of that power user sheet. We'll go into that at the end. That's what it looks like, and we'll do that. But first, we'll go back to page one. And again, the green fields are UAD fields. Not all of them have a pop-up window. The property address we click in there does. You enter in the street name and street number in the first box, the city, state, and zip in the others. It's primarily a pop-up box because of the state. This address needs to be USPS or US Post Office valid, and that primarily relates to the state. If you click on the down arrow, your only choice of state will be the US Post Office two-letter state abbreviations. The states need to be two capitalized letter for each state. So states like Utah and Ohio that you can spell out, if you were putting that in the state field, that wouldn't be valid. Tennessee, if you're using T-E-N-N, or Montana, M-O-N-T, those aren't valid. Tennessee would be T-N, Utah would be U-T, Ohio would be O-H, and Montana would be M-T. So those examples. If you use the pop-up window, the only choice you have are the valid ones, so it's no, you know, you don't have a choice to get it wrong. It makes it there. But if you're using the power user sheet or clone your report and the data's there, just be aware that's the primary thing as far as it needs to be USPS standard addressing, and that state abbreviation is the big one. The zip code and the city, those are generally match up, but if you do have something where your local standards or appraiser standards, you have a city or a zip code that's at variance with what the US Post Office has, you need to go with what the Post Office has if you get in that situation. But some of the fields that are green that don't have pop-up windows, tax year, there's no pop-up window. The formatting is deemed to be straightforward. They're looking for a year, which at this point in the game is a four-digit number. I just enter in 2010, for example, leave the field. It turns it white, which is a valid and correctly entered UAD field. No big deal. Now, if I would have accidentally left off a zero and tried to leave the field, this is one of those variances on the first look where you can get a field that isn't a UAD valid field, but it turns it orange. So anything you see that's orange on your report, that's an indication to you that, hey, this field is not valid content for UAD. It varies, obviously, what would be wrong with it. In this case, it's that I don't have a valid year. All I need to do is put in zero to make it valid, and we're good to go. Real estate taxes, that's a number field, same as special assessments and HOA. Anything that's asking for a dollar value or a number, the formatting, as I said earlier, no letters can be entered. It has to be a number only, and it has to be rounded to the nearest whole number. So if my real estate tax is $1,280, I just enter those in, puts the comma in, we're good to go. Special assessments, if I don't have any special assessments and I try to put in N for none or N-A, it doesn't let me. Again, remember, if it asks for a number, you can't put in any letters of any kind. You just would basically put in zero if there isn't any or if it's not applicable. Now for HOA, say my HOA is $80 a month, or I'm sorry, say my HOA is $79.88 a month, I would just make that $80, you need to round up. So if you most of you probably do that anyway. If you're not, you want to get in the habit of it with UAD because that's required. If I tried to put in $79.88, what's going to happen is because all the rounders, the numbers need to be rounded, it ignores the decimal point. So it turns $79.88 into $7,988. Obviously way high and way wrong. You would just enter in 80, you round it yourself, and away you go. Let's go down to the 12-month prior history. This is where we got our, not our first pop-up, but our first pop-up where we have some questions to answer and some assistance. These pop-up windows kind of work like TurboTax. You have certain questions you need to answer, certain fields you need to fill out, and it will help you. If you try to leave a field with something that's not filled in that you need to, or something filled in incorrectly, it'll pop up an error telling you, and what you need to do. And then once everything's filled out and you save it, it'll enter all the information you typed in or entered or selected into the field in the proper UAD format, which is a little bit complex. We'll see in a minute once we get it loaded in. So that's kind of how these pop-up works when they come up. So at the top, I have two questions, one of which I have to answer. It's the first question is yes, the subject is currently offered for sale or has been offered in the last 12 months, or no, the subject is not currently listed nor has been offered in the last 12 months. I'm going to go ahead and choose no for right now, and then if I hit no and hit save, it's not going to let me out of here, because even if I answer no, either way I answer that first question, I need to provide at least one data source must be entered, and it lets me know it's not going to let me out of the field until I get that done. So here we go, data sources, need to put one in. I'll go ahead and put in my MLS. If I had a second MLS, I can add that in, and as many as needed in there, and then once I've got no and my MLS in there, I can save out. It checks the box for me and enters in my data source for MLSs, which are the minimum requirements if I answer no. Now, if I answer yes, it's going to free up all these fields in here of which I have to answer. If I had yes answered and just my data sources and tried to get out, again, it's not going to let me. It's going to say, hey, you need to fill this in at bare minimum, so keep going. So it says the days on market must be specified or UNK, or must be a whole number UNK specified. So up here, we've got the days on market. If you know what they are, you enter them in. If you don't know the days on market, you check the box DOM unknown. It puts UNK in there. I'll go ahead and put in that I have days on market. I'll say I know them, 120 days. And then you've got a box here, properties for sale by owner. If it is, you would check the box. If it's not, you would uncheck it. I'll go ahead and check it in this example. And then here we have spots for the original list price and list date, the latest list price or list date, or current perhaps, if it's still currently listed, and then other changes, other price changes or other prices, and then other list dates, price change or intermediate listings, that would be those. So for original, if we say we have days on market, we need to specify that. We'll say the original list price was $219,000. And then list date, we need to specify that. We can click on the month, the date, or the year, and we highlight it, and we can make a change. Enter that in, or you can use this little calendar control over here. Click on this little icon, brings up the calendar control, and you can sort of arrow forward and back, and then just double-click on the appropriate date that you want. And then latest list price and list date, or current one if it's currently listed. We'll say it's currently listed, and it's a little lower. We'll say $189,000. And then list date, we'll make today. I think we'll say it's current. And then other list price and list dates, be price changes. We'll say we had one of $199,000 in May 17th. Double-click that, select that, and we have to add. And if I had other intermediate listing to price change, I would just keep putting them in, specifying the price and date, and add them until I get them all in there. And then once everything's filled out, I hit save. It will populate the field with that data that I selected accordingly in the UAD format, which is days on market first, no space, semicolon, subject property was listed for sale by owner, period, semicolon, latest price, semicolon, latest date, and then original price, original date, other date, and then the data sources or data source or sources. You can see most of the elements are separated by no space in the semicolon, but we did have a comma in there, so there are some exceptions to that. And the key is if you were typing this, you would have to type everything in this exact order with this exact spacing and punctuation. If you had an extra space in there, wrong punctuation, it would be an invalid field. But you don't need to worry about that. The program, these pop-up windows take care of it for you. You just fill in the information, select the choices, answer the questions, save, and then it gets it in there in the UAD format for you. So that's the general overview of how those pop-up windows work. Let's go to basement area. Let's go to view. I'm sorry. View is a field where it has requires new information now. Location will be the same way when we touch on that. Terms like average, good, poor, fair, similar are not acceptable. Have to pigeonhole the view and then later on location into one of these three choices, neutral, beneficial, or adverse. And it's technically the view's influence on value. Does it have a neutral influence, a beneficial influence, or an adverse influence? Have to choose one of those. I'm going to go ahead and choose beneficial for this. And then you've got factors in here like water view, park view, golf course, mountain, industrial, et cetera, limited site. Have to choose one factor that kind of justifies your choice here. Can choose up to two, but no more than two. There's also an other option. If nothing on this list is appropriate, you can choose other. And then down here in this box, you can describe what other is, whether it's railroad tracks, plaza view, busy freeway view, et cetera. But I'll go ahead and I'm going to choose Golf Course View and Mountain View, which are my two personal favorites, and then I hit Save, and it loads the information in the form, capital B for beneficial, semicolon GLFEW, semicolon MTN. And this is where we could go to the page two of the definition of terms, look at the abbreviations, and say GLFEW, that's Golf Course View, MTN, that's Mountain View. So that's how you can integrate the definitions page and kind of look at it, and that's what the borrower or whoever would want to do if they had questions. They had that resource to go see what the terminology is or the abbreviations are. Basement area, we'll click in there. Your choice, if you don't have a basement, you can just check the box, no basement, save, and it puts 0 and 0 for the square footage and the finish percent. Otherwise, if you had a basement, you would need to specify the total square footage of the basement. We'll say 650 in this case. And then you've got a box for finish percent and finished area. If you put in the finish percent, it will calculate the finished area for you. If you put in the finished area, it will calculate the percent for you. So you have to only do one of these, and it will figure out the other. Whichever information you have, whatever your preference is, you can just put in. So I'll just put in, say, 520 finished square feet. And then when I click out of there, it calculates the percentage for me, which is 80. Or I could just put in a number, say 75 in here, or use these up and down arrows to sort of come to a percentage that I want. We'll go down to 50. And then when I leave the field, it calculates the finished square footage, which in this case would be 325 square feet. Then over here, I need to specify the access method to the basement. Is it interior only, walk up, or walk out? I'll stick with interior only. And then I also need to specify the room breakdown of the basement. Our choices are rec room or recreation room, bedrooms, full baths, half baths, and other rooms. I'll say one rec room and one bedroom. Save it. Puts in the total square footage, the finish percent. Outside entry is not checked, which is appropriate because I said interior access to the basement. Go down on page 2 here in the grid, and it's got the total square footage, finished square footage, line 1, room breakdown on line 2. Pretty straightforward. It does the legwork for you. Just know that a couple appraisers during these courses say that they use this rooms below grade line for other amenities and stuff because either they have no basements or they just put all this information on the first line. Once UAD hits, you're not going to be able to do that. If I click in this box, it's going to show me the same screen or pop-up window I saw on page 1 where I can set the sizes and the room counts. Nothing on here is going to allow me to put anything but this room breakdown, which is good because if I had anything else in there, it would not be a valid field, and when I went to upload it, it wouldn't let me. So just know if you're using this for something other than room breakdown, even if you're in an area where there's rarely, if ever, basements, you're going to have to discontinue that once you do UAD and use one of these free agent fields or elsewhere for that information you put there. All right, let's go to rooms. We've got total rooms, bedrooms, bathrooms. Whichever the fields of those three fields we click in, it's going to bring up the same screen where we can set the total rooms, bedrooms, and the bathrooms here all at once. You've got total rooms, bedrooms, full baths, and half baths as our choices. You can use these up and down arrows to sort of make a choice, or you can pop in there and put in, not 70 rooms, that would be like Bill Gates' house or something, 7 rooms. You can put in the number, or you can use these arrows to like sort of run up and down your room counts. Also, there's 7 total rooms, 4 bedrooms, 2 full baths, and 1 half bath. And I hit save, populates the field for me, as well as here, page 1, as well as the grid. Pretty straightforward. I just want to point out the bathroom count. That is the requirement for UAD with bathrooms. It's whole bathrooms dot half bathrooms. So in this case, we would have 2 full bathrooms and 1 half bathroom. If I had a larger property and say I had 5 full baths and 3 half baths, that would be 5.3. So if you have been using 0.5 for half baths, like, you know, 2.5 baths would be 2.5. You want to watch that or discontinue it. If you use the pop-up window, you know, it'll get it right. But if you're cloning or carrying in from the inspection sheet, you want to watch that because 2.5 would not mean 2.5 baths. Once UAD hits, that means 2 full bathrooms, 5 half bathrooms. So kind of just be aware of that. And also, there's no room for quarter baths or 3/4 baths. They need to be categorized as either half baths or full baths accordingly. They don't make any room for that. Generally, round up or round down for general, I think 3/4 baths round up to full, 1/4 baths go to half baths, even though someone said in their area that half bass or no bass. But either way, you have to categorize them in either full bass, half bass, or not at all. There's no stipulation for quarter or three-quarter bass. All right, condition the property here. We've got a lot going on, but initially we have to choose at the top. Select the overall condition rating for this property. Click on the down arrow. This is where we get our C1 through C6 choices. Now they're paraphrased on this screen. If it was the entire word-for-word definition for each of them, this would take up your whole screen. So we just paraphrase them here. If you want to see the full definition, you can go on the help button. And all the pop-up windows have a help button. They do certain things as far as different things, depending on the form. In this case, but most of them all, they should tell you at the beginning what's required for the field, which in this one is the appraiser must select one overall condition rating for the subject property and comparable property from the list below. So one of these C1 through C6, it ends with saying multiple choices are not permitted. So you can't choose two, you can't slash, you know, have to choose one and only one that's most appropriate for the subject and the comparables. And it describes the entire definition word for word here. So if you're on the fence between, you know, a C2 and a C3, you can come in here, see the full definition, see if that clarifies it. Then it comes down and talks about the updating. They're looking for improvements. And, you know, again, what the not updated, updated, remodeled definitions are. We saw that on page one of the definition terms, but it's also here as well because this is where you were going to use it. And then at the bottom here, it talks about the time frame that you need to refer if there are any improvements or remodeling. And then finally, description of comments. The appraiser must provide a description of the condition of the improvements of the subject property. So at bare minimum, your comments must include that, and you can provide other information as far as the condition of the subject, but it must provide any of the improvements to the property itself. So that help button, anytime you have a question, if you get an error when you're trying to get out of one of these pop-up windows, or if you go in there you're not sure what to fill in or what's required, the help button is a great first resource to go look and try to figure out. It should tell you what you need to fill out, what sort of information needs to go where if you have any question about that sort of stuff. All right, so we have to choose one of the C1 through C6. I'm going to go ahead and choose C3 in this case. And then we've got a box here. Property has not been updated in the last 15 years. So if it has not been updated, I would check the box. If it has been, I would leave it unchecked. And in the middle here, you've got a spot for kitchen improvement and bathroom improvement. And the choices for each are not updated, updated, remodeled. So I'm going to go ahead and say the kitchen has been remodeled. The bathroom, however, has not been updated. And then whenever you choose one of these have been either updated or remodeled, you also have to specify a year since completion over here on the right. Your choices are less than a year ago, 1 to 5 years ago, 6 to 10, 11 to 15, or unknown. I'll say it was remodeled 1 to 5 years ago. And then we've got this white area. It's a comment area. Not all the pop-ups have comment areas. A lot of them do, but not all of them. The first one we looked at with that 12-month prior history pop-up didn't have one, but this one does. And I said, like I said, a lot of them do. They all work the same way. You can right-click in one of the comment areas, and it will give you a choice of any saved comments you have, whether they're UAD specific or not. Anything you've had saved in this condition field previously will be in the list here, and you can just select, click on one of the options and paste the text from that comment into the form here or into the comment area. I can also type in there proactively that I need to. If a word is misspelled, it'll underline it in red, and then you can right-click on that underlined word. It'll give you a list of choices it thinks you're trying to spell, or you can just, at the end of it, do right-click on one of the underlined words and do spelling, and it'll spell check this whole comment area, and you can just make corrections accordingly. So that's it. And then also, if I type something in new or edit existing stuff, I can right-click and save a comment. Name it and save it in there so I'll have it in my list down the future, and I can tailor UAD comments in there. So it's pretty much how the F2 keys work on the comment fields on your main form before UAD. It's just the F2 key doesn't work on the pop-up windows. You have to use the right-click option to get to there. So I've got all everything filled in. I'll hit save, and it loads it in the field, C3 for my condition. Kitchen was remodeled 1 to 5 years ago. Bathrooms have not been updated, and my applicable comment accordingly. Pretty straightforward, gets it in there. Now let me go back to the comment area and talk about a couple of things relating to that. I've got a green box here in the upper right-hand corner that talks about character remaining. It's sitting at 3630. It started at 4,000. The UAD, if any of specifications on these comment areas on UAD fields is no more than 4,000 characters. And a character is defined as anytime you hit the keyboard, a letter, number, symbol, punctuation, even the space counts as a character. Or if you populate text, same thing. Any letter, number, symbol, punctuation will deduct from the characters. It keeps track for you because once you get down to zero, in other words, you've got 4,000 characters in this comment area, you're not going to be able to enter anything else. You're either going to have to stop there or go back and remove some stuff or abbreviate to add some more stuff because that's a requirement. It keeps track of for you. So just be watch of that. When you're getting near zero, that's the end of the line. So kind of we count it for you. The other thing is this comment area, what we have typed in here, fit in the field. It varies how many lines are in the field. Some of them have two or three lines. This one condition, they have a lot of text for it, so there's 4.5 lines and it fit. It works the same way if you've got comments in there that don't fit. I'm going to go ahead and add some more in here so that we run out of room. What it will do is it will add the text if it doesn't fit in the available lines on that field in the form. It'll put it into a UAD comment addendum. You can see we've got it here added in. UAD comment addendum, and it's got the field header in bold, and it's got my text in here that's spilled over from that main form in the condition area here, and in the line it will say see comments, and then the field header or field name, that's what it puts in there, and then feeds the UAD. Now, if you have a UAD comment addendum in your report, and you could add it from the forms library, there's this UAD form, a folder, and you've got the three UAD fields. This is soon to grow, but the UAD comments in there, and you could add those in proactively, but you don't have to. If the form's not in your report, the program will automatically add it in if you have a need to put text into there. The other thing about this UAD comment addendum, not the regular one. The regular one you can click in and type on the form itself and do what you want, but the UAD comment addendum, you're not able to click in here. If I try to click in here and add the text or change it, it's not going to let me. It's going to pop at this box saying the comment text on this page can only be edited by the cells that originated them, which means the only way I can get any text in the UAD comment addendum is in these comment blocks here on these pop-up windows. So you have to add text in here or enter text in here that doesn't fit. That's the only way to get in the UAD addendum. Again, you could have the regular addendum, the non-UAD comment addendum, and type in that just like you have before on the form, put over stuff. But the UAD fields, from there, the comments in there spill to the UAD comment addendum, and the only way to get them in there is through the pop-up windows in the comment areas. All right, let's go to the grid here. Like I said, a sea of green. Got a lot of pop-up there. I won't go over all of them, but we'll go over some of them here. First off here, we'll go into the subject area for data sources, verification sources, sales of financing concessions, date, sale, time. The fields are white. They're not green nor blue. They're white because they're locked out. If I click in, they're yellow, but I can't type anything in there. Fannie Mae says basically this information is addressed on page 1, and it doesn't forward to the form. You don't see it, but it doesn't want you editing it in any way because it's answered basically on page 1, not here. So these fields are locked out, not able to be edited, but just know that they're addressed and answered on page 1, and they don't show up here, but they lock out. It's just the way Fannie Mae wanted it, so that's what we do. So don't be put off if you can click in here and can't type anything on UAD. So, location, however, is green, so it is a UAD field and we can't type in it. And it's much like with view. You have to choose one of these three options, neutral, beneficial, or adverse for the location. It's technically the location's influence on value is a neutral influence, beneficial, or an adverse influence. I'm going to go ahead and choose neutral. And then you have these factors here, same thing. You can choose one factor or up to two, but no more than two, and there's another option if nothing on this list is appropriate, and I can describe it down here. I'll go ahead and just say adjacent to power lines, but not a big deal, and then we've got N, and then ADJ, PWR, and there, and away you go. Now, I'm not able to copy this if I use the equal sign. If I click in there, because I've got the pop-ups, I can't use the equal sign and copy it over. I can use the right-click menu, but I have to go into a blue field or a non-UAD field and then choose right-click, and I can choose copy sale and then go into a blue field or non-UAD field and right-click and choose paste sale, and it will paste the information over, but you can see it's orange, which is, again, orange is an indication of a invalid UAD field, not because the content isn't correct, because it is. This is the right UAD format. The problem is the UAD cell is a separate entity. It's sort of at the bottom of it. And when you copy the data over, it doesn't pick it up. So I click in here. You can see, even though it's listed here, these boxes aren't checked because it didn't pick it up. So I would need to just check it and confirm what I had before. Same with the condition here, C3, it didn't pick it up, so we have to do that. And when we do, then the fields are no longer orange. So that's what you can do. You can copy an entire column from one column, the subject, or comparable to another, and it will copy the data over. It's just in many of the UAD cells, they'll come up orange, and you have to click in there and select the information or correct it so it's UAD compliance. I think they're going to change that and get it away, and there'll be, when we go into the power user, the subject inspection sheet, there will be a comparables inspection sheet a little way down the road, a couple weeks in an update, that will allow you to edit information quickly and copy it across once that comes in. But in this form, if you can copy and paste data, but UAD cells are probably not going to get picked up and they're going to turn orange and invalid, that you'll need to correct those. Now, if I have my comparables filled out and they're in UAD format, I can swap them around. I can go comp 1 to comp 4. I can go comp 5 to comp 3, move them around, and they will move around, adjust, and keep the UAD compliancy correct. But if I go from a filled-in cell or column to a blank one, it'll copy. It just won't pick up the UAD stuff, and you'll have to go in there and correct that. Quality of construction. That wasn't dealt with on page 1 for the subject, so we have to do that for the subject and the comparables here in the grid. And this is where we have our Q1 through Q6 choices, and they're paraphrased here. Again, so this screen doesn't take up the full window. We can go under the help button and see the word-for-word definition if we're on the fence between one of the choices, and it tells you up here what you have to do, which is one and only one of these choices down below. You can't choose two. It's most appropriate for the quality construction. We'll go ahead and choose just Q3 in this example, and then we'd run across and choose Q2, Q3 for the other comparables that need to be in C, the condition as well. All right, let me talk about adjustments. Adjustments, you can put three things in the adjustment field. You can put a negative or positive adjustment as is appropriate. Pretty straightforward. That number needs to be rounded to the nearest whole number. But you can do positive or negative. If adjustment is warranted, you just enter that in. You can put a zero, or you can leave the adjustment field blank, but there are specific directions on which ones you choose. If you have two elements that are identical, you're looking at two elements for consideration of a adjustment, and they're 100% identical, you would leave the field blank. If you have two elements that are very similar, but there is some difference and you're considering adjustment, but your determination is the difference between the two doesn't warrant an adjustment of any kind, that's when you would put in a zero. And then if you got two things you're looking at that warrant an adjustment, you just put in the appropriate adjustment. So let me go over that again, because that's caused some confusion. So if you look in two things, like see here, we've got C3 and C3, and my determination is they're 100% identical in this case, then I would just leave the field blank. Here we've got C3 versus C2. There's a difference, and it warrants an adjustment. I enter in the adjustment and round to the nearest whole number. Pretty straightforward. Now, if I have Q3 here and Q3 here, and they're not identical, and because of the definition, there's some wiggle room to where you can have the same designations, Q3 and Q3 and C, whatever, and C2 and C2. They're not identical. And so here, Q3 and Q3 for quality construction, it is not identical. There is some difference, but I look at it, and the difference doesn't warrant any sort of adjustment. That's when I would put in a zero. So that's kind of how adjustments work in there. Let me go down the bottom here. Another thing on the grid that we're getting some questions about when people start using it is this date of prior sale, a transfer, price, the prior sale section here on the grid. If you have a transfer sale, you put a date in here. It's asking for a date, so it's got to be a date only, no other letters or anything else, just the numbers and the slashes appropriate for a date, and the price rounded to the nearest whole number, no letters or slashes, anything like that, so just the date and price. However, if you don't have a sale or transfer, you are to leave this entire column blank. I know it's sort of at odds with what you've sort of come to accustomed to in most cases. Lenders may not like it, but that's the specific edict from UAD is if there isn't a sale or transfer, you just leave this entire column blank. Don't put any letters or, letters in there, no sale, no transfer for pre-foreclosure, whatever. Just leave it blank. Otherwise, if you do have one, enter in the date and the date only here, the price and the price only here, the data source, and the effective date of the data source in there. So kind of just know about how that works because we are getting some questions of tech support relating to that. So once we've got everything filled in, then we don't, of course, but assume we do, then what we need to do is create a UAD file, at least do a review of the data, and or create a UAD XML file of it. I'm going to go ahead and sign this right quick. And the way I would do it, the review and the UAD XML file creation are in the same spot. They're under the file menu, and you have this create UAD XML. We click on that. And it's going to show you the list of forms here, and it's got a UAD review button up here. If you've seen the RELS module, use that. It's similar to that look. You do need to review this regardless. So even if we're not going to create an XML, we still need to go through the review. So we click review, and that will go through, and that will look at all the fields on the form, UAD form, UAD fields, and non-UAD field likes in all forms included, and it will break down the alerts into two different type alerts, errors and warnings. Errors 100% absolutely have to be corrected. You have to be at zero errors on the screen to continue and move on. Warnings aren't necessarily, don't have to be dealt with. If it's a field that you intended to have filled in and you didn't by an omission or accidental, then you would correct that. Otherwise, it may come up with some warnings that you don't have to worry about, and you can continue with warnings. But errors, you cannot. In this case, we have one error. And also down below where it lists the errors and warnings, they'll be listed here. The errors will be highlighted in yellow because it's highlighted. That's a big deal. You have to correct that. This orange field, we have the one orange field, and that's causing the error. And you can either click in the field itself to correct it because this is when we copied that data and it didn't pick up all the UAD information. Or on the error where it lists it here on anywhere on the form, if you're not looking at it, you can just click on this column that says locate in this little gray button with three dots. And it will jump you to that part of the field automatically. And then once you're there, you click in there, and then you do what you need to do to fix it, which is just select these elements. And then once I correct it, and I go UAD review, got no errors, and we're good to go. And then I would continue, and then it'll get us to the PDF. This is the PDF file preference option. When you create this UAD XML file, it's going to do three things. It's going to review the data, which is what we just did. It's going to create a PDF file of the full appraisal and save it on your system. This screen talks about where it's going to save it. You can choose browse here and select an alternate location if you want, what it's going to name the file, and I can review the PDF before I create it. That's what this screen's talking about. And then the third thing it's going to do, it's going to create a valid UAD XML file, which it, is going to be required down the road and may be required now. And that XML file is going to contain all the information in the report into that in the raw data format in the XML. It's also going to have an embedded copy of the full PDF file in there as well. So technically, all you need to do is send your client the XML file. The PDF is in there if they want it. But in some cases, they may not be able to know how to get it or deal with it, especially at this stage of the game. So it creates the PDF, and you can send them that if that's what they want or they can't figure out the other file. And again, it does this for you. This is just basically telling you where the options are set up to do it. Now I'll hit Create XML, and it will pop up a Save As window, and it defaults to a save location, which is the UAD XML Files folder, which is under your MyClickForms data folder. And then it also gives the file name to the XML. It adopts the ClickForms file name to the XML. But this screen comes up because it gives you a chance to change where it's saved and what it's named if you want to. But you don't have to by any means. If you want to put it in the desktop and give it a different name for it's easy to find, you can do that. But by default, it'll name it and save it for you. We're going to go ahead and leave the defaults, hit save, and see this green bar here. That's about the only indication that's creating the XML. We didn't get an indication that it successfully created it. It's basically no news is good news. If there is an error or a problem, it'll pop up here, and you'll see an error that there's an issue and tackle it. If you don't get an issue error of any kind, basically it created the XML file and you're good to go. So no news is good news on when you go to create the XML. If you don't see anything after that's done, that means it did correctly. And just for a ballpark, XML file on my machine, you know, takes about 3-4 seconds. I'd say the average is about 3 seconds on the low end. The fast end, 10 to 15 seconds on the average, the slow end, to create the PDF. It depends on the speed of your machine, the size of the report and such, but I'd say 3 seconds on the fast end, 10 to 15 on the slow end as a ballpark. But like I said, it will tell you if you got an error, otherwise it created it. And then you would just email either the PDF to the client or the XML file, upload it to their website, or you may just submit the report just like however you have been. That's most likely what's going to happen at this early stages. They want the field here in the UAD format, but they still want the report through Appraisal Report or the other modules that you've been sending to that point. So if they don't tell you that they want something different, just fill it in with these UAD requirements and submit the report like you normally would, whether it's through the modules, whether it's as a PDF or otherwise. But it does save the PDF and the XML, and you can either email those directly to the client, upload to them a website to accommodate their requests. All right, that's a general overview of how the UAD First Look works and the creation of the XML file. Let me get out of here, and then I will go into and show you kind of the power user form. That's that power user. If you're in services and you select power user, it'll still look exactly like it is in First Look, everything with the color code fields and all that. What it will do, though, is it will put in this UAD subject details form, which you can always add from the UAD forms folder on the thing. And what it does, it has not just UAD form fields, but some of the other subject fields, and they're kind of bundled together for quick and easy entry to get it filled in, into the form. And then once it's filled in, you hit this transfer UAD button here at the top, or they have it at the bottom, and then it will take this data that's filled in and load it over to the form in a flash, and ostensibly then you should be good to go. Now, doing it this way, like I said, there are a couple fields, like the state and some other things, where you can have entries that are not valid UAD fields. It'll still load them to the form. It'll just turn the form orange. You're going to have to correct that. But this is sort of a quicker and more efficient way. I think the design would be a good idea would be to do your first couple, 2-3 reports and the First Look that we saw earlier, so you know how it works. You get the hang of what UAD format is about and the information is. And once you have that, then come use the inspection sheet here, the subject details worksheet, and fill it in. Get a little more speed and efficiency back, and then you hopefully won't enter in invalid UAD data because you kind of know what it's about. I won't go over all the fields. You got address, you know, parcel, tax year, real estate, all that stuff, owner, and I'll just fill those in. But let's go with the AMC name. Again, this is, remember, that was at the lender client name at the bottom of page 6. There's nowhere on the main form that it asks for it. The lender client field here fills in the bank name. This would be the name of the bank is where that goes and their address. For that page 6 signature, they're looking for the AMC name. Well, we've got the spot there. So you enter in the AMC name. We'll just put, Giant Corp. And then it'll carry on to page 6. We'll show that when it transfers. And then we'll go down to, and then it's got the 12-month prior history stuff in here that we could fill in with drop-downs, and I won't go over those, but we'll just go down to the site characteristics. So influence on value, we've got view and location here, and instead of the pop-up windows, they're put together because they're both the same choices, and we've got prefab choices. These are already in here. There's no F2s, save. They just automatically pop up when you click in the field, and you can either click on one of them, double-click to select it, and then it jumps over to the next field, which, remember, we're here with view. We need to choose neutral, beneficial, adverse, and then a factor, one of the factors that are listed here. And you can either use your keyboard or your mouse and select it accordingly. This is factor 1. If we had another, we would do it. Then factor 2, we choose whatever that is, which is mountain view. And then we're back to location, and we neutral, beneficial, adverse. We'll go adverse. And then factor, we'll say, is adjacent to landfill and public transportation or power lines. And so we can fill them in with the drop downs, and it's quicker. And then we'll go down to improvements here, and then we'll have our improvement for the condition rating. Here's the condition rating. We'll start, the property has not been updated in the last 15 years. If it hasn't, you leave it unchecked. And then foundation, basement has evidence of infestation, dominance, settlement. They want that. But then we're kitchen improvement. Here we go again. Not updated, updated, remodel. It's prefabbed in there. We'll say the kitchen's been remodeled, and that was 1 to 5 years ago. Bathroom has not been updated, and we can just skip that. And then go over the condition. This is our C1 through C6. We choose that. Construction Q1 through Q6 there. And we've got our comment that we put in there accordingly. And then once we go down and just fill everything out, and you can fill in, you can get to the point where some of the stuff you fill in the first look with the pop-ups is you're more comfortable with that. Others you fill in here, so you can use them both at the same time. And just whatever's the most efficient, use either both, one solely or the other, to get it filled in and UAD compliant. In this case, once it's filled in, I just hit this transfer to UAD. And in about a flash there, we'll go, and it's got it filled in here. We've got our view selected in there and UAD appropriate. It's got our basement stuff filled in, room counts, and we've got our condition. There's condition C3, kitchen's remodeled, and our comment loaded in there. And we go down to the grid, and we've got location filled in, view, quality construction, condition, and it just loads it in there for the subject, and we're good to go. And then on page 6, go down, and there's our management company name where it needs to go from that. So that just gives you some speed and efficiency with it. Just another way to go in. Like I said, you can use that solely or in conjunction with the sort of first look pop-ups, whatever's comfortable, or you can go all first look pop-ups, you know, sort of pro and cons weed. But whatever is good for you, then you can use in combination to get, like I said, the most efficient way to fill out a report and be UAD compliant. Now there'll be the there'll be a comparable sheet for this that's like this, which is the comparable stuff where you fill in and copy and paste, drop-downs all coming out in a couple of weeks for the grid. But for right now, we're just dealing with the subject and that and going from there. So that pretty much concludes our training. I want to thank you for watching. I'll give you an email address for UAD that we have 24/7. It's a good contact for any UAD-related issues, questions, concerns, suggestions you may have. It is UAD@BradfordSoftware.com. That's UAD as in Uniform Alpha Delta or Uniform Appraisal Data at BradfordSoftware.com. Jeff Bradford sees that email. The developers, tech support, we all look at that, and it's the best 24/7 resource to anything related to UAD. You have a question, concern, suggestion about, fire off an email there, and we'll get it and go forward with it accordingly. All right. Once again, I want to thank you for viewing, and you have a wonderful afternoon or evening. Thank you.